Good afternoon. This is Jerry Theodorou. I'm the director of the Finance, Insurance, and Trade Program at R Street, the Washington, D.C.-based public policy organization. Thank you for joining today's webinar on the Florida insurance market. The Florida property insurance market has been the subject of much discussion. It's in trouble. Observers have characterized it as collapsing, as having collapsed, as troubled, as cratering. And there is a special legislative session next week, which may attempt to solve some of the problems that are ailing the Florida property insurance industry. And here to discuss these issues with me is David Paul, the principal of Alert Consulting. Alert is A-L-I-R-T. David is an analyst whose work I've known over the years, and I'm very impressed with the depth of his analysis, the breadth, the understanding of the industry. Because beyond just looking at the numbers, David understands what's behind the numbers. One of the legends of the insurance industry, the actuary Brian Duperreault, has said that regarding the financials of insurance companies, the numbers don't reveal their secrets easily. But David is here to explain what is behind the numbers as we discuss this issue. David, thank you for joining us. And would you like to introduce yourself and your company?
Sure, Jerry. Thanks, obviously, for having me. It's great to be here. Alert Insurance Research has been around for 23 years. We specialize in analyzing the financial strength of insurance companies. So you can think of us as kind of like a private rating agency. My two partners and I have actually worked together for 30 years all in. We started our work in Hartford, where I know, Jerry, you are, as a spinoff from Conning, a company called Townsend & Shupp. So we've been looking at the life and the annuity, the PC, and the medical health insurance market for many years. And Alert differs from rating agencies in that we're out modeling the financial results of individual insurers kind of at the statutory entity level every quarter. So we're tracking, the 1,700 PC companies every quarter by running their statutory and GAAP data into our model. And we have a scoring system instead of a rating system, which allows us a more targeted kind of rifle approach to understanding the trends at these companies. So that's what kind of provides us with some added insight into what's going on.
Great, thank you. At R Street, David, we've written a number of articles and op-ed pieces in recent weeks calling attention to the symptoms of an ailing insurance market in Florida that's ailing because of litigation and factors that are not related to hurricanes, because as we were discussing, there hasn't been a landfalling hurricane to hit Florida since 2018. So I said that there are symptoms of an ailing market. What are these symptoms that I'm talking about? There are insurers that are leaving the state. Those that are remaining are highly unprofitable. Several Florida-only insurance companies have become insolvent. Rates for homeowners insurance are rising, and it's difficult for homeowners to secure insurance. The insurer of last resort, Citizens Property Insurance Corporation, is now becoming the insurer of first resort. So these are some of the symptoms of an ailing market that I see. Am I missing anything, Dave, or would you like to comment on any of these symptoms?
Well, I think you've kind of answered your own question. You ticked off a real good list of things there. You know, as a credit analyst, as an insurance analyst, obviously it sounds very simplistic, but probably the greatest symptom is just the sizable operating losses we've seen out of these companies in this market, really going back. I've been looking at them for 30 years and almost going back that far. In a recent study, we pointed out that since we've been looking at the market, there's been about 80 what we call small domestic Florida homeowners insurers come into this market. As of our latest release, which was a couple weeks ago, I think 22 are now out of business, insolvent. So, you know, looking at a 25% insolvency rate is not normal, as you know, in the U.S. Property casualty industry. So that's really the biggest symptom we see. And where does that come from? I mean, obviously, the operating losses come from poor underwriting results, and that's both reported in accident year results. And as any credit analyst knows, when an insurance company loses money, unless it's backfilled by some net capital gains or outside capital support, the surplus in these companies is going to fall. And when it falls to a critically low enough level, then you start to have some real problems. And that's been a trend that we've seen in this market over the last two decades. Right. The other things you pointed out were right. You know, the non-renewals, the exits, the sales and mergers. You know, we've actually even seen some money come into the market, some private equity money. A couple other things I'd point out, I think reinsurance rates, you noted. I mean, that's certainly a symptom that reinsurance rates are very high. We've seen Demotech, which is a very important rating agency for that market, allowing the government mortgage guarantors to actually take mortgages. You need to have a Demotech rating on the insurance company. They've started to downgrade. And obviously the insolvencies would be the worst possible symptom. And we've seen four of those over the last year alone. And it looks like there may be a couple on the horizon from our perspective.
Right. And actually, I want to comment on that a little bit or drill a little deeper, where you say that insolvencies of property casualty insurance companies are rare. That's absolutely true. There's about 1,500 property casualty insurance companies in the United States. And on a typical year, there's 5 to 6 insolvencies. And Florida is now accounting for the bulk of those. So whereas the insolvency rate is about 1/3 of 1%, Florida has got so many of these insolvencies. Now, I'd like to mention that David, so your report on the Florida market, excellent report. And in that report, you characterize the Florida insurance market as artificial. Artificial is the term that you used. What do you mean by that? Why would you say that the market is artificial?
Well, for me, an artificial insurance market, because I'm an insurance analyst, is one that really strays too far from the laws of supply and demand, which, you know, in a capitalist free market system really regulate all markets, right? So I'm not naive. I understand that government regulation is important, including rate regulation. And I think on balance that our 50 state insurance oversight system works quite well. And so I understand that, yeah, you need some government oversight. Obviously the government checks, keeping insurers honest, all of that. But if you stray too far, you're gonna run into problems. And I think honestly, Florida has just strayed too far. And if you will, I mean, I'll explain what I mean by that. In our report, we kind of referred tongue in cheek to the Florida property market as Rube Goldberg type machine, right? So it's an artificial construct with all these different moving pieces. And if you go back 30 years to when Andrew hit, from that point, and obviously understanding in a crisis mode, we saw the residual markets get set up that ended up merging into what's now Citizens Property Insurance Company. And what happens then, of course, then the state starts to offer incentives for companies to come in and set up these small companies to take risks out of Citizens. And they do that by offering things like bonus payments. They obviously offer some very attractive financing, some cheap surplus notes. You know, they subsidize a reinsurance, obviously, through the Florida Hurricane Catastrophe Fund. And, you know, through this whole period, there's artificially low rates, right? Either they're not approving the rates that these takeout insurers want to get at periods of time, or Citizens certainly has mandates about only allowing a certain amount of rate. And so when the storms do hit, and we're talking storms, not fraud, which I imagine we'll talk about later, but in 2004 and five, we had, you know, a combined series of 5 storms that really hit the market hard and put some companies out of business. Citizens surplus went negative, et cetera. And what they do is they go out and they raise money in the bond market, and then they essentially assess the whole Florida, almost the whole Florida market, to pay that back. So these are all the different elements that exist in an artificial market to try to keep rates low, palatably low for political reasons. But as we've seen again, and we're at that point again, a flashpoint, it's artificial. And at some point, as you know, you just can't go against these laws of supply and demand without having these types of problems occur again and again.
Yeah, and you talked about regulation. Insurance is regulated at the state level. So as you go from state to state in the United States, you see different markets, but Florida really stands out as being very different. And you described all the reasons why it can be termed artificial, the insurer of last resort, Citizens, and the creation of these small Florida-only companies that are meant eventually to take policies back from citizens in the process known as depopulation is not working currently. So you've got repopulation of citizens because the private market is unwilling to take on business which is going to be unprofitable. So you have this unique situation, this lay of the land, where you've got this giant in the form of citizens, and then you have these Florida-only companies, many of which are undercapitalized, several of which have failed, as you mentioned, over 25%. So it's an unusual landscape. So if we can step back a minute, Dave, would you want to give our listeners a little bit of understanding of the Florida market? I've introduced that it's different. How big is it? And what are these categories of players? One thing that strikes me as I study the markets, if I look at the different states and homeowners insurance in all the states, the top 10 homeowners insurers, as you go from state to state, you see the familiar players there. You see USAA and Geico and Travelers and Hartford and the Liberty Mutual and Nationwide. But when you get to Florida, you don't see that. You see that you've got Citizens, you've got a couple of publicly traded Florida-only companies, and then you've got these Florida takeout companies that are a special breed of their own. So can you give our listeners a little bit of a description of the landscape of the Florida market? How big is it, and what does it consist of?
Sure. And as of 2021, statutory data, the data that comes to us from the insurance departments, the homeowners line in Florida was $12.3 billion. That's just homeowners. It doesn't include allied lines and fire, which would be lumped in there, but much smaller. So just to give the listeners a sense, the composite that we wrote about, these small domestic insurers, there's 37 of them in our report. They're about 65% of that market, so 8%. Citizens would be another 10 to 11%, about $1.3 billion. And then it's interesting, we call them the big five, right? So when we do our research, that would be AIG, Allstate, Chubb, Progressive, USAA. They account for about 16%. So that gets you just over 90%, gives you a sense of the size of the market. What's important in that statistic, as we know, AIG is now pulling out of the market. Progressive is not pulling out, but I think it, you know, maybe 10% it decided 55, 56,000 risks they're going to non-renew. So we're starting to see even those players obviously pull back from the market. What's interesting though, when you talk about Citizens, and I keep a little quote here because it just always reminds me, going back to your question about artificial markets, this came out of the Florida OIR, but it said in a release, Citizens is required by law to recommend, and I'm reading it, actuarially sound rates, okay, while complying with legislative glide path. So think about this, a glide path is, okay, you're allowed to raise rates maximum, I think it's maybe 12% next year, it was 11% this year, something like that. Well, we know that they need more than that, right? So basically the legislators are saying, yes, you have to offer actuarially sound rates, but we're not gonna let you do it. Mm-hmm. I think of that and it's like, you almost can't wrap your mind around it. And I think that it almost encapsulates the problem right now in Florida. We know what you need to do, but we're not gonna let you do it.
Yeah, it's a catch-22 situation.
Absolutely.
And, yeah. And David, you mentioned before reinsurance, and the role of reinsurance, of course, is to provide insurance for insurance companies. And the take-up rate of reinsurance is very high in Florida. If you look at some of the smaller companies, certainly that they reinsure more than 50% of their premium to reinsurance companies that are in Bermuda or continental Europe or in the Lloyd's market in London. And the renewal date, the time in which the treaties, the reinsurance treaties that provide this kind of coverage for Florida property risk, the treaties are renewing on June the 1st, which is a few days away. And industry sources, people that we talk to, market reports have indicated that several of the large reinsurers that provided capacity, that provided coverage for insurance companies writing Florida risks, are pulling back on Florida. Because it's unprofitable. And there is and you mentioned it earlier, David, the Florida Hurricane Catastrophe Fund, which has been set up to provide reinsurance for the Florida companies to the extent that private companies don't want to, is there as well. And there are suggestions that it expand. But I think that if they take on more risk because the private reinsurance market stands away from it, you're really just shifting the risk from the primary companies to the state-sponsored reinsurer. So the citizens of Florida are going to end up paying for it anyway. So that's not a real solution. And the reinsurers are going to quote and charge the rates that they need to in order to earn their cost of capital to get a decent return. And we're not talking about, you know, jumbo returns. It's a very competitive market. It's a global market. There's reinsurers in other pockets of the world as well. So those are my thoughts on reinsurance, and they're a little bit depressing. I wonder if you've got any thoughts on reinsurance that I haven't covered or that needs to be thought about, because it's going to be critical. If especially these small companies don't get the reinsurance that they need, they're not going to be able to provide the coverage that they do.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Your numbers were right on. I think we had a 54% cedence rate to non-affiliated reinsurers, so not excluding any type of intercompany type reinsurance. So your numbers are right. Obviously, reinsurance is critical to this market. One, because it's thinly capitalized and it faces some large storm losses. So, whether that's quota share, whether that's excess cat type coverage is critical to the market. Your point is correct. These small Florida domestic insurers and property insurers face what we call a Halverson's choice, right? They're going to either have to buy the right amount of reinsurance, and now it's become very expensive, as you pointed out. And we've seen this in the past. That's a choice, but what happens is they either have almost no net premium left or even negative net premium. And that's, if you can't exist that way, you're getting ceding commissions, but that pretty much pays for your expenses. And then it's kind of a slow bleed to insolvency. The other choice is not to pay for the insurance and roll the dice. And that is extremely risky in that geographic area of our country. So it's a problem. And we've seen companies do it both ways, and we've seen both types of companies go out of business.
Yeah. The report that you did on the Florida market, that excellent report, really goes into great detail. It shows the numbers, the financial performance of the industry, and a lot of the data about their financial strength and standing. The combined ratio, which is the measure of underwriting profitability, is above 100% for just about all of the Florida only companies. Investment income kicks in a little bit. Not a lot, though, especially for the smaller companies. They don't have sizable investment portfolios, so you don't have a lot of investment income. In a sort of normal insurance company, you'll have investment income contributing 5 points or more for property for first-party insurance. But do you want to give us just a little bit of a sense of how bad it is? I mean, I've seen numbers of like 117% combined ratio, which means that you're paying out $1.17 for every dollar that you take in on the underwriting side, and there's no hope of making that up with investment income. So how bad is the patient?
Yeah, it's bad. Your numbers are pretty close. I mean, we're close to a 120 for the last couple of years. So 20 cents loss on every dollar of premium. And to your point, I mean, we look at it. I mean, the Florida, because it's a short tail line of businesses, property, this property line, and because they're thinly capitalized, they really can't take a lot of risk on the investment side. We see investment income, you know, adding, you know, 1 or 2 or 3 points maybe for that composite. So it's pretty bad, to be honest with you. And again, it's unsustainable. You can't take these types of losses year after year after year and stay in business. And again, we talked about before the laws of supply and demand and the laws of, call it the laws of capitalism, which says, you know, if you keep losing money and there's no way to backfill it, at some point you just go out of business. And that has been, it's happened slowly, it's happened quickly, it's happened in different phases over my, again, 30 years of looking at this market. And, you know, quite honestly, this is probably one of the more critical times I've seen.
Right. Actually, a question just came in on the Q&A. Area. Thank you very much for submitting that. Asking what is the national number if Florida is about 120. I would say that the overall combined ratio is tending around 101, 102. Is that about right?
You're right on. I mean, we run a personal lines and a commercial lines composite. And I think just think about break even, 99 to 101. Last year was actually decent for the industry. So I think they both came in just a little bit under 100. But so break even is normal. And people listening who don't know insurance would say, well, that doesn't make sense. It sounds like they're not making any money at all. Where the fact is, and you brought it up before, this industry historically has made most, if not all, of its profits through the investment flow of holding surplus and premiums on their balance sheet. So they may break even or lose a little bit of money in underwriting, but they more than make it up on their investment income. And certainly net capital gains kicks in as well.
Good. Well, we've talked, David, about the symptoms of the problem. And then, like a good doctor, we need to get to what is the source of the problem, what really is driving these symptoms. And here we've got to look at some more numbers, which are even more depressing. In a report that was done recently by the Florida Office of Insurance Regulation, we learned that Florida has about 8% of the nation's homeowners policies and about 8% of the nation's homeowner claims. Okay, 8% sounds about right because Florida's population is about 8% of the national population. And the depressing thing is that Florida has got about 76% of the nation's homeowner insurance claim litigation, according to that report from FLOIR, Florida Office of Insurance Regulation. And it's actually gone up. It's now about 78%. So it's got about 10 times as much litigation, even more than 10 times, than the rest of the country. So you've got an explosion of litigation that's going on there. You have roofer schemes where roofing contractors are knocking on doors and offering to go and look at the roof and get a claim paid by the insurance company. And sometimes the roofers are actually causing damage themselves. And they go from door to door. And people that are living there say, gee, my neighbor got a free roof. I can get one too. And then if the after the insurance company denies the claim because it's not covered, then there's litigation and you have these fee multipliers. You had this state law that was passed in 2017, which opened the floodgates for these fee multipliers, where the payments from the insurance company would end up being about three times the cost of the roof, because their fees were covered. If they prevailed in litigation, their attorney fees were covered. So a $30,000 roof becomes a $90,000 insurance claim. And you've got tens and hundreds of thousands of these things going on. So you've got an explosion in litigation. Would you agree with me, Dave, that this is really at the heart of the problem, the litigation explosion?
This is at the heart of the problem, no doubt. And you and I have talked about this before. There's really, over the last decade or more, honestly, you have to kind of go back to 2004 and five to see a large series, some large hurricane losses, but certainly a series of losses. Obviously, 2018, we saw a sizable loss in the market. But outside of that, there really has not been these large kind of catastrophic hurricane losses. So your point is 100% correct. This has tended now to become a fraud problem. Of course, we're seeing what they call secondary wind events, which, as you know, are, you know, they're not, they don't reach the level of a hurricane category. But, you know, the frequencies of these storms bring in hail, bring in wind, bring in rain, obviously. And so that's become a problem, not only in Florida, but across the Southeast and certainly the Southwest and even up into the middle of the country. So we're seeing a greater frequency. But it's really how this, and you know, it's interesting, this isn't new to Florida, this idea of fraud or litigious type society. I mean, you go back to the 90s, you see the issue of mold and you get it going back even, you know, longer than that, you have the sinkhole issues in Florida. I mean, Florida's geographically, we always say geographically challenged in this regard. And in each of those instances, you saw kind of a litigious group, you know, the trial bar and others kind of build up around those issues and take advantage of them until the legislators were able to tone it down or to kind of take it out of the picture. And so this is kind of another, now we're seeing the assignment of benefits abuses, the roof issues you talked about. This is kind of the third iteration in my career of what we've seen as regards this type of litigious type environment in Florida. And again, it really has to be dealt with because those other two instances I talked about put companies out of business as well.
Right. And I mentioned that June the 1st is the date for the reinsurance renewals, the renewals of the reinsurance treaties for property in in Florida, June the 1st is also the official start of the hurricane season. So if the wind blows this year, which it didn't in the last 4 years, and strikes Florida, you really are going to have a major collapse. You're going to have a major collapse. And the fact that it's been easy to sue in Florida, easier than in other places, the numbers that I cited before demonstrate that, amplify and exacerbate the situation, which, as you correctly pointed out, is not one that was driven in recent years by catastrophes. We haven't had a landfall catastrophe hurricane in Florida in the last 4 years. And you have all this sophisticated modeling that was introduced after Hurricane Andrew 30 years ago. So the tools are there, but it's the structure and the environment in Florida, the legal structure and the strength of the trial bar, that's preventing these kinds of improvements and changes to be made. Well, next week there's a special session in Tallahassee to look at the insurance situation in Florida. There's not a lot of hope that there will be solutions that come out of that, because typically when there is a special session, you've got to have both houses agree, the Senate and the state legislature. The Senate has advanced these, but it's stalled historically with the Florida House of Representatives. And I don't see signs that they're agreeing, making an agreement before that on wording that can be voted into law, and we'll have to wait for the general session. So let's keep our eyes open to see what's going on in Tallahassee next week. And any closing thoughts that you have on solutions beyond roofing? A lot of talk about going to actual cash value rather than replacement cost, putting limits on assignment of benefits, which is still going on, even though it was officially closed a few years ago. There's ways that around that attorneys are doing, but other things that you'd like to see done there?
Well, I mean, listen, I always say almost cut the Gordian knot. I would say get everyone involved in the insurance industry in Florida, maybe bring in some outside people who don't have a dog in the race, get everyone in a room outside of the public eye and say, what rate do we need? What is actuarially sound? What rate do we need? Bring in actuaries, bring in claims people, bring in underwriters, bring in the management, bring in the CAT modelers, all of these people, get them in a room so that you can bring to the OIR, listen, we've talked about this. This is what we need in a free market environment. These are the rates we need, and then start to discuss what can we get, right? Now, I was talking with the head of a large broker, a national broker that's based in Florida, and I mentioned these ideas. They said, hey, that's all great. Your problem is you're thinking about this in a rational manner. Yeah. So we're dealing with political exigencies clashing with market realities, right? And we know that sooner or later, again, this Rube Goldberg machine may continue to exist, if you will, but at some point, the reality of collapsing insurers is a reality you cannot avoid. And we're seeing it right now. I'm telling the listeners, at alert, we're seeing it in the scores, we're seeing it develop as it develops. So there's not going to be a choice at some point unless we want to have everyone in Citizens or the vast majority. I mean, we keep a chart, Citizens. We've seen two peaks, and I know we're out of time, but in 2006, there was a peak. Back in 2011, after a period of higher reinsurance pricing, there's a peak. We've seen the numbers go from 750 policies in Citizens. It's going to be, they assume it's going to be over a million again at year end, and could be even more. So we're seeing a kind of a hyperbolic rise in the policies in Citizens. And if they don't solve the problem, it's going to be even worse than that.
Absolutely. I agree with you 100% that solutions should be looked at dispassionately without anger, emotion, or blame. These are numbers we're talking about. Numbers don't lie. And as you say, when companies are leaving the state or collapsing, something is wrong. So the discussion needs to be data-based, nonpartisan, looking for solutions that make the most sense, recognizing that Florida does stand in the way of hurricanes. The peninsula and the Gulf are more exposed than other states. However, there are other states that are also catastrophe exposed that have not had this kind of crisis. So Florida is a special case, but its characteristics need to be recognized. So looking forward to rational solutions. I like that word, rational. Brings a smile to your face, David.
Yep.
Thank you for joining us, and thank you to all of you that have joined this call. If you have questions that are left over that occur to you later, my line is always open, Jerry Theodorou at the R Street Institute. Thank you, David, and thank you all who have joined us today.
Thank you, Jerry. Appreciate it.